So I'm trying out these MGN12 linear sliders. They're a bit hit and miss. This side feels really good, but that side not so impressive. I've also redesigned my plates for my CNC machine, so they're a bit smaller, and use this system. I'm gonna have to do quite a few different things to get this running. I want to experiment with different methods of moving the plates, and I do have some SFU 12-04 ball screws, which I think I've got an idea of how to fit them within the track to run the plate across. But before I do that, I need to make a jig to hold my dial gauge in a particular position so I can make sure the two rails are nice and parallel, and then I think I'll be able to use that as well to check how the blocks run as well. So I'm not going to do anything too fancy. I'm just going to 3D print something with the mounting holes, and then to make sure that this lines up, grabbing my protractor, just working out this angle. And it looks like 30 degrees to me. Yeah, looks like 30. Okay, if I just backtrack, you can see what I've done. So I create a new sketch. I've created a rectangle that's 50 mil across by 40. I've then created the holes using the circle tool and the rectangular pattern, which you can find in the sketch tab. Then I offset the hole so that these are in the center, and then I've extruded that, although I've done that thing that I normally do and I've forgotten to create a new component. So I'll click on that again, E for extrude, say 6 mil, new component, okay. I then created a new sketch on the top of the square component I just extruded. I made an angled rectangle where I wanted the mounting section to go. So I've added a constraint to make these two lines parallel and those two lines parallel. Now I can change this. I've worked out the offset and now that's perfectly in the center. But do I want it perfectly in the center? I extruded that with a joining operation, and on one of its faces created a new sketch with the shape and opening for the attachment bolt. I extruded that, this time with a cutting operation to leave the desired shape, and then went around with the fillet tool to round over all the edges and make the jig a little more ergonomic. Okay, just add a bit of strength to this after I 3D print it. I'm going to create some fillets around this section here, maybe 2 mil, maybe 1.5, I think. And that should still give me enough room around these openings for the machine screw head and maybe a washer. I also created a recess for the machine screw heads, as mine were a little short to attach fully into the MGN12 block. So this jig will allow me to keep the bars parallel, but I'm going to need to make something else to keep this edge of the rail 4 millimeters in from this edge of the C-beam. You can take these blocks off the rail, but you've got to be really careful not to pivot down or up as you do so, otherwise you can pinch the bars. This particular block is running really nicely. Every now and then you get one which is a bit stiff. So I need to work out a way to improve this, and I've got a few methods I intend to try. If I turn the rail and block around so you can see the ball bearings,
and I hold the block steady and move the rail, what you can see is that in this particular block that there's no gaps between the bearings. The blocks that seem to stick seem to have gaps in the bearings. Also, this seems to like moving in that direction, but come back that way around, I can feel it gets stuck there.
There may be a bit of burr on the metal, or the plastic hasn't been formed properly, but the only way to find out is to open one up.
Let's take this one apart and see if I can replace the bearings.
I put down a piece of chamois leather and kept a magnet nearby, both of which to help prevent losing any small bearings or screws. I then began the fiddly process of dismantling. I quickly realized I needed to dismantle a few blocks to compare the pieces.
I'm going to take another one apart as well, and I'm going to compare the two just to see how similar they are.
After checking the main metal block with a caliper, I concluded it's more likely to be the balls which was causing me problems. But before I replaced the balls, I decided to take a bit of wet and dry paper and try round over the ends of the tracks the balls ran along. Maybe there's a slight burr that I can't see or feel.
That's 15.48. So even though these seem pretty good, there was a slight difference in the movement of one compared to the other, and I think it's basically a dud ball in here.
Also rebuilt one and placed a bit of fresh lithium grease along the track, but this didn't help. I then remembered a jig that Pocket 83 built to help him sort out marbles, and went about building something similar for my purposes.
So this is the jig I've made. It's got two steel bars running along the top of the jig, and I've divided the trough into several sections. I'm using playing cards to help keep the balls in the correct distribution so they don't bounce off into other sections. Problem I found with this is these linear ball bearings are so small that they just don't weigh enough to kind of fall down the track by themselves, so I'm having to push them along, and I'll push it along until it eventually drops into one of the areas. The other thing as well is, because these are so small, I'm finding adjusting the bars by hand really difficult. So what I've done is just tension the clamp at the end here ever so gently to try and create a distribution that I can actually see. The first few times I did this, I was literally just getting everything landing in either one or two of the trays. So I think the clamp has slipped a little bit. So tricky this. I'm gonna have to start again. So I literally got one in this one here. I'm gonna run that down again to see if that was an accident. And that was. So I don't know how that popped out. Okay, I'm not getting consistent results despite the bars being solid 12 mil steel. I don't know if it's the movement, me having to push the balls along, that maybe is forcing these to pull out a little bit. I mean, I can see them flexing even this short distance just by hand.
Because I had the row of cards as a reference, I could see slight variations in how the balls dropped, but my range was limited to roughly a couple centimeters, the width of the pockets.
I could try hold a ruler along the channel and instead read where the balls drop against the ruler by the millimeter, but I'm not sure I have the patience to do that. I'm going to wait for a jeweler's scale to come in the post, one which can measure at increments of 0.001 of a gram, which I'll try use to detect any variations in the bearings. What I'll do in the meantime is something a little more simpler and clean the blocks by soaking them in some alcohol.
So I've actually bought extra blocks. They come in with a sort of bit of plastic to hold the balls in place. This simply slides off and I can just dump that in. The thing to try and do is to move the balls around in the solution. So after cleaning all the blocks, you can see quite a bit of stuff has managed to come off. I think this might be the secret. So it's worth buying a few extra bearing balls. For this particular type, it's 3/32 of an inch, just in case you lose some. And if you're really meticulous, take the whole thing apart and soak the parts in some alcohol. I'm using methylated spirit. Alternatively, you can just pop the whole block in and use a tiny screwdriver to just shuffle the balls along until they loosen up a bit and improve. And then I think after which you apply some clean lithium grease, not too much because obviously that can suspend dust and particles in it, and return them back to the rail.
I'm going to make another jig now, which will help me set the first roll at a fixed distance against the side of the C-beam.
So I'm going to use these scrap bits of aluminium that were actually for the X-carve to extend the height of the gantry. Made these quite a while ago and I kept them just thinking I could use the aluminium. What I'm going to do is use these three points to secure the piece onto the C-beam, and then I'm going to drill a hole in line with the rail which I can pass a machine screw through, which I'll bolt at a particular length, and that will be my stop. This face here is 4 millimeters away from this face here, which should be according to my 3D model, and the center of the rail is 44 mil from the bottom of this. So I think that's pretty good on the scale of things. There's quite a bit of wiggle room because obviously the machine screws are only M3 and the gap is, well, nearly 7 mil. I'm just going to cut this down so it makes it a bit easier for me to actually tighten the rail down. Okay, the next thing I'm going to do is butt two rails together and see if I can slide the block across them without too much deflections or problems. So I can kind of feel that they're a little bit like this. I mean, it's barely anything, it's not super noticeable. Something is affecting the movement.
I decided to return the dial gauge to the shorter rails to test something. When I checked the first rail, it was pretty consistent, but then I flipped it over to the opposite side.
The deflection along this edge is 0.15, so
this is a reminder that the rails are not perfect. Along with measuring against the opposite guide block when fitting the rails in future, butting rails together will need additional work. I then took off the two rails I had tried to butt together earlier and first filed the edges and returned the pieces to test. I also sanded the pieces with a bit of wet and dry when they were secured to the C-beam. This definitely improved things, but I later realised there's also variation in the roll guides, so some could slide better than others. I even tried a few other things, for example shimming one rail against the other, but that didn't seem to work.
So really the most important parts to line up are the angled or beveled sections in the groove, one at the bottom, one at the top. I can feel that with my nail. If I just run that along there, that's pretty smooth. And if I concentrate the sanding in that place in particular, that should also help smooth that up.
And eventually I realized the best thing to do was feel the rails with your fingernails and just go at them with a multi-tool and a tiny grinding attachment. I got some movement across the rails, but I think the secret to using this butting method is to buy all your rails and rail guides from the same supplier. And if you're planning to extend the rails, to do so in equal measurements and to hope that all the parts you bought have been made around the same time from the same batch, so the manufacturing tool wear isn't too noticeable. Anyway, this video has really dragged on and I still need to make a decision on how I'll be moving forward. But I've already started cutting test pieces out for some new plates that I'm designing, which I'll talk about more in the next video. If you want to see the rails and guide blocks that I've used in this video, I'll link to those in the description below. So that leaves me with the last thing to say, which is thanks again for watching, and you'll catch me in the next one.